All right, my name is Dane Elliot. I'm here today with Dick Boucher to do an oral history. Today is August 29th, 2016.
And I'm Dick Boucher, on the same date, and also an ex-Intel employee, retired.
Okay, excellent. So we're gonna start with the beginning, okay?
Okay.
And I'd like you to tell me a little bit about the family, where you were born, raised. I know that's not in the outline we worked up, but it's kind of some background that we'd like.
Okay, let's see. Born in Chicago, Illinois in 1927, and raised in a little town in Wisconsin called Manitowoc, not too far from the Green Bay Packers. And grew up there and met my wife there when we went through high school together in Manitowoc, and then went into service. I was in the Navy for a couple years, got out of the Navy, went to school at St. Norbert's College.
Now, St. Norbert's was a local?
St. Norbert's was in De Pere, Wisconsin, a Catholic college, right outside of Green Bay.
More Green Bay here. So last weekend you were happy that Green Bay beat San Francisco.
Yes, and it was very easy.
Yeah, too easy,
yes.
I would agree. Okay, so tell me a little bit about St. Norbert's, and you went in for a degree in chemistry. Why were you selecting that particular field? And you know, a little bit about the college itself.
Okay, when you say I selected the field, I'm not sure I gave it a lot of thought. Came out of the service and knew I wanted to get a college education. And so I went to St. Norbert's. I got very interested in the chemistry. So I did a lot of chemistry courses and actually got my BS degree in chemistry. But actually I took one course in microbiology and thought it was really great and interesting. So then I applied to go to my graduate work at the University of Wisconsin in microbiology. I actually got a degree in bioengineering and microbiology, meaning it was the microbiology not related necessarily to medical stuff.
Interesting to me that microbiology and engineering in terms of microbiology was something that was actually subject matter in the 50s. It just seems like a long time ago. Today everybody talks about, you know, microbiology and how it's related to going and doing compute later on, but microbiology probably didn't mean the same thing at that time.
Probably not. Microbiology at that time was more medical, and what I was in was this, the end of relating to industrial, more the fermentation field and that end of the business.
Surprised you didn't end up making wine somewhere in your career.
Actually, in graduate school, we did make wine. Now, I'm not sure it's part of the course.
Okay. And then at a later point in time, you went to work, but at a later point in time, you went back to school at UC Berkeley. Tell us a little bit about that and what the motivation for that was.
Actually, I went to school at UC Berkeley while I was working at Cutter Lab. Mm-hmm. And I was in the biological end of the business, but I was in manufacturing of biologicals. So I went back to the University of Wisconsin and got a certificate in production management, which included finance and all the things related to production, how you manage it, how you make it successful, and so on.
Okay, so now you have the capability of not only creating the products and all, but you have the wherewithal to manage the development and production of this as well.
Yes.
Okay. Was that an overt goal at that point in time, or did it just come out that way?
I think it probably came out that way. I found out that I wasn't a researcher, even though at Cutter I had developed, I was running an anthrax group for a while, and at Cutter, I developed an avirulent vaccine for anthrax. But I didn't consider myself a researcher. I enjoyed more the manufacturing and the managing of getting products out.
Okay. Now, this is at Cutter Labs, which you joined in 1952.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. For those of us who are not educated in the biological area, tell me what avirulent actually means.
Avirulent is a anthrax is a virulent bacteria that kills animals. Mm-hmm. And virulent means it kills people. It gets into your bloodstream and kills them. I located a strain or developed a strain that was avirulent, but when you put it into a vaccine, it still produced immunity for the animal.
The antigens necessary for that. Okay, I understand. Now, you also did a lot of work in human biologicals with blood and plasma and serums and vaccines. Mm-hmm. Other than that, what were those?
Well, when I was put in charge of producing all the human biologicals before I left Cutter, and that means we used the eggs and all kinds of things for producing the different vaccines. And then also I ran the blood fractionations group for a while, where we would get people contribute their blood, and we fractionated into the different components to get the different immunities that are in the blood to give to they don't produce immunity. What they do is give you immunity. And so I ran that for a while also.
Okay, good. How would you characterize Cutter as a company and your experiences there?
Oh, well, it was a first-class company. The guy that ran it was Dr. Bob. I don't know whatever happened to him, but it was a company that took care of their people well, treated them well, and gave people great opportunity for moving around into different jobs.
Excellent. But you did leave there in 1958. Where did you go from there?
In 1958, I went to a company called Biofirm, which is in Bakersfield or Wasco, California. Two people that had left Cutter had gone to work there, and so they recruited me to come to work for them and be in charge of their assistant director of development for developing fermentation and chemical engineering and so on. And I ran their pilot plant. Which was in Wasco.
Right, okay. One of the products I know you worked on there was the glutamic acid, which I assume we know commercially as monosodium glutamate.
It's a precursor.
Precursor?
What happened is we had developed a fermentation process to produce glutamic acid. And then glutamic acid can be converted to the monosodium salt, which you refer to as accent. And so, in fact, that particular process was a result of that. The company was bought by International Mineral and Chemical for the process to get this fermentation process because they were extracting monosodium glutamate from molasses, sugar beet molasses, and big storage tanks. Very, very messy, difficult process. And also lots of contamination when they dump the stuff down drains and so on.
Okay. So we have contamination problems long before
we
get into the semiconductor world. So monosodium glutamate was not invented, or accent wasn't a new product as a result of what you did. This was an alternate way to achieve the product?
Yeah, it was a fermentation product, the glutamic acid, and then you convert it to the monosodium salt, and now you have accent.
Interesting. Okay. Turns out that it's still a huge business.
I haven't paid any attention here. Is it, they still sell accent?
I believe they still sell accent. I don't use it myself, but I don't use much salt, so I wouldn't look at that.
But the plant that they had in San Jose is closed down several years ago, so I have no idea even though I hold the patents on the process with another fellow, I have no idea if they're still using the process or not. So the $1 I got, they probably owe me another dollar.
That's all they paid for patents back then,
that's
a dollar.
That's right, yeah.
Interesting. Okay. So moving on to International Mineral Chemical in San Jose, basically everything was just the consummation of what you developed at Biofirm Corporation.
Yeah, but we had to put in all the tanks and all everything. So, but I essentially managed the conversion of the process from sugar beets to fermentation products, and then its ultimate, you know, converting to the monium sodium salt.
Can you tell me what the difference in costs in doing it one way versus the other was?
You know, I don't think I have a real good handle on that. My guess is, but I'm guessing, that it was monumentally cheaper.
Yes.
Because you're using bacteria to produce a product, and you didn't have to store molasses and haul it across the country and get rid of the discharge.
Right, interesting. Okay, well, after International Mineral and Chemical, you moved on to Memorex Corporation, which I believe was at the beginning of the corporation. Now, to me, as an outsider, it looks like this is a huge change for you, going from chemistry and producing monosodium glutamate ultimately to the computer world, where it still may be not related to semiconductors, but it's really related to the magnetic tape that was in use so heavily at the time. What motivated you to make that change, and how different or similar was what you did for Memorex?
Well, the reason I made the change is that two of the fellows I worked with at Cutter, Rex Lindsay and Larry Noon, started Memorex along with Larry Spitters. Mm-hmm. And Noon and Lindsay came after me and wanted me to come in and run their manufacturing, because I had worked for both of them at Cutter. Again, keep in mind, I wasn't the technologist running, but I understood all the technology, and I was running the manufacturing of human biologicals. So moving into another kind of technology, but manufacturing, I thought would be something I would like to do and could do.
And did you find it so?
Yes. Yeah, I did very well at it.
Okay. And I know we kind of touched on this, but you basically set up a manufacturing plant to produce plastic reels for computer tape. So what was being used before plastic reels?
Well, no, we were using plastic reels, but they're very expensive. And this was the beginning of management by objectives. So we had put together different management, and one of the objectives was to produce a plastic reel for $2 or less. And so the result of that was we built a plastics facility in Los Angeles to produce plastic reels, an injection molding plant.
Okay.
And it was successful.
Okay. And one of the things you told me before was that a lot of the materials came from Europe, the base materials, I assume, the polyesters. Tell us a little bit about that and why you did that and what a duty drawback really is.
Actually, we were buying the tape that you put, computer tape, the basis was the polyester, and we were buying it from companies in the U.S. initially. But we then converted to buying from companies in, still the U.S.-owned companies, but we bought them in Europe. So when they brought the products into us, they had to pay a duty, and we worked out a duty drawback. So we drew back a significant reduction in costs by drawing their duty back that they paid, because we're using the product in the U.S. that they'd pay duty on.
Okay, and this was a program that was sponsored by the federal government?
No, it was a program allowed by the federal government. As if there's a big difference, but it's not something anybody was doing at the time. And I'm not sure how we fell upon it, but it worked out very well. I went to to Europe and negotiated an agreement and worked out extremely well.
Okay. Were these companies the same company you had started with in the U.S. and just their European plans?
In fact, it was DuPont.
It was DuPont. Okay, excellent. How were they in terms of being pleased with this kind of a deal? Did they make more or less money on it?
They continued to have our business, which made a big difference because we were a big user at the time. Mm-hmm. So it wasn't a threat. It's just that that's the way they maintained their leverage with us.
Okay. Now, just to be clear, the tape that you were creating and using was used in computers, right?
Yes. Not,
okay. Did you eventually go into making this for videotapes?
Yes, we did.
Okay.
Yes, we had videotapes and other types of audio tapes. But the big products were videotape and computer tape.
Okay. Same kind of quality issues and whatnot for both of them, or?
Video is much more demanding than computer tape.
Really?
And depending upon where you use it. Some computer tape used in heavy NASA events and so on, that was very demanding. But the videotape was probably much more demanding.
Overall. Basically, because people can see the results better or not, as opposed to just recording information.
Well, in computer tape, it's more than recording it. It's the ones, if you have a flaw, if you have what you call a dropout, then it destroys the storage of the information.
Did they use any error correction codes or anything at that time?
I think that's before. We're really early here.
Really early here, okay. Because I know that in terms of improving the quality, ECC came along, did a lot for digital tape, okay. Now, the videotapes, however, they weren't digital videotapes at the time. They were
analog.
Analog. Right. Okay, good. You want to take a drink of water?
Yeah, please. Okay. Thank you.
No problem.
Ooh, that helps.
Yeah, it does.
Okay.
Now, you mentioned the fact that there was a time when you were responsible for metal reels, and I didn't understand the issues there. Do you want to elaborate on that?
Well, some areas of the in the government, they didn't use plastic reels, they used metal. And we had a company in Los Angeles called Substrate Corporation that produced them. And I happened to run that.
Okay. So it was basically a customer requirement.
Yes.
There were certain customers that weren't happy with plastic. So we had to have that on it. Okay. And tell us a little bit about the DISPAC development that was also, I believe, done down in Los Angeles and then brought up here.
Yeah, our development of DISPAC manufacturing did the initial work down in Los Angeles. And I think it's because there was some equipment down there that we needed. And then we moved it up to Santa Clara and built a plant for it. And we were then into the DISPAC supply.
Okay, and by DISPAC you mean rotating media
on large computers?
Mm-hmm. Removable media?
You mean
you can take the disc out, put another one in?
No, they were disc packs. In other words, they were storage media. And you took a whole pack and moved it into a disc drive.
Okay, so this was like some of the early IBM machines that I learned on, where you had a drawer and there was a disc pack that could be changed out in there. Not a lot of storage on those, as I remember, compared to what we do today.
Yeah.
Who was the customer for the DISPAC? Was that an IBM related issue?
IBM, but the big storage companies.
Okay, so back in the day, it probably would have been in the Honeywells and the Burroughs and a number of other large corporations. Okay. Now, you're also part responsible for P&L there. So tell me a little bit about that and the revenue growth that you managed while you were there.
Well, I was responsible for what's called the information media division, and it was producing about $50 million in revenue per year. But the dispatch prices have dropped tremendously, 35%, 40%. And so we had to cut direct costs and marketing by 20-30% just to stay, which we did, but difficult to do. But we stayed to stay alive.
Mm-hmm. Now those didn't last, obviously. We have completely different media
at this point in time.
So basically, what happened to the corporation in that business? In what time frame?
Ultimately, I left, and ultimately it was, I think it was sold to Burroughs, but I'm not sure.
Okay.
When I left, they were still doing okay, not fantastic.
Okay, but the writing was pretty
yes.
much on the wall
yeah. mm-hmm.
that this was going to be superseded by something else. Okay, any other comments about Memorex that you think should be included here?
No, other than that, it was a good company to work for, and they treated their people very well, and I enjoyed working for them. And
good. Okay, you did a short stint at Electronic Arrays. You want to talk about that a little bit?
Yeah, I was approached to go over there to be the president. Actually, it was the president. There's two in a box. And the other one was Noyce, Gerson, who was very ill at the time and in and out, but a very tough guy. And so the two of us sort of managed the company. So I introduced management by objectives and some other things that I had learned at Intel, and also introduced got them going on the first microprocessor program.
Now, a lot of people don't recognize the fact that Electronic Arrays was in the business of developing microprocessors. And this is obviously after Intel had introduced the first one in 71.
Yes.
But they were going for a lot bigger fish, if my memory serves me correctly.
Yeah, it was, I was only there for a year, so it wasn't anything that was, they weren't working anything significant. As I say, we started the first microprocessor program. But then I left before it came to fruition.
Okay. And what was Electronic Arrays like beyond the fact that, you know, Moishe and you had a...
We had a good relationship. It's just that I had never worked in a two-in-a-box situation before.
But you did subsequently.
I have subsequently seen a lot of it. I don't think I've ever done one personally, though, at Intel.
Okay. That was certainly a a big thing at Intel at
yes.
one time or another.
Yes.
So, okay. And so after the year there, you were recruited to join and run Microma. Now, I've done a little bit of research there, and I understand Microma was originally started on the East Coast, which
I didn't know. I didn't know that either.
And then moved out here, and I've still got some details to work out, but one of the guys that I've been talking to was talking about the original patents were introduced, were actually obtained by an East Coaster and started there, so I need to work out those details. But you came on in like 73.
Yes, 74, I think. 74, 73, 74.
Okay, and you were hired by Bob and Gordon. So
yes.
Tell us a little bit about the motivations there and what you walked into when you joined the company. And again, there's a transition here, okay? And motivation for the transition would be interesting.
I was very impressed with Bob and Gordon. They were, giants even then. In the industry, so I was very flattered that they were even considered me. And then I interviewed also with Andy Grove. Mm-hmm. And as a gross understatement to say, a very straightforward, demanding kind of manager. And we sort of hit it off. So it was, but going into Microma wasn't going into Intel. It was Microma was a small organization, not necessarily well run. I don't know if I said that right. But I mean, it wasn't being closely managed.
Okay.
So it was a very difficult startup getting started for me.
Okay.
And understanding everything that went on.
Now, two of the founders were Don Rogers and Bob Robeson.
Yes.
And I don't think you really ever knew them, so I assume they were gone by the time you...
I knew Robeson, but not Rogers.
Okay. So he was still there when you...
No, he was came in a couple of times.
Okay. Had a vested interest.
He had a vested interest. And of course, his vested interest he'd probably already taken out.
Okay. Okay. You hired and managed a bunch of people who've turned out to be superstars in a lot of other areas. Why don't you tell us about them?
The Keith Thompson ran manufacturing, and he was a right-hand man of Andy Grove's. And so I was really pleased that Andy said, well, he would, if I would be willing and wanted, he'd have him move over, and Keith came over. And then I hired Jim Beck to run engineering. And Des Fitzgerald also came over from Intel, and he ran quality control. And he really did a good job at Intel, so I was elated to have him. Mm-hmm. I hired Irv Cooper from sales. I'm trying to think where Irv came from, but he'd run a sales organization for someone else. I'm trying to think where. Can't think of it right now.
All right.
And then I had Simon Chang, hired him for LCD development. And Rich Millman came in for marketing. And Liz McElfish ran personnel.
Simon Chang was a particularly interesting hire and very instrumental in making the whole thing come together, I believe, because of the LCD development.
Yes.
You want to talk about that a little bit?
Yeah, in fact, Bob and Gordon would come over often to look at the LCD display stuff that Simon worked on. So he was really instrumental in getting the LCDs to be an acceptable product and worked well so that they never had any problems later on, but initially a lot of work, and he gets the credit for doing that.
Okay. Now, just for reference, the state of the art before LCDs was LEDs, light emitting diodes.
Yes.
And the big deal was that light emitting diodes consumed a lot of power, so the watch was only on when you wanted to look at it by pushing a button or something. Whereas the LCD was a continuously viewable display because it used so little power.
It was a watch. An LCD display was a product where you could tell the time if you wanted to, but you couldn't tell the time all the time.
Okay. How big, Jim Beck ran engineering. How big was the engineering organization?
We probably had 10 to 12 engineers.
Okay. So not huge, but substantial.
Not huge. Oh, yeah. But pretty good size considering the time frame and so on.
Right, right. I mean, there certainly weren't larger teams at Intel building chips at the time.
No.
Now, and these guys did semiconductor engineering, developing the original CMOS devices.
Actually, Intel still did the design of the chips. And our engineers met with them to tell them what we wanted in the chips and what they had to do, and then check the chips out, you know, in products.
Okay. And I believe at that time that was probably the only fully CMOS device that Intel was producing.
I think you're right. That is.
Okay. I mean, today everything's CMOS.
Everything's CMOS, yes.
It was back then, it was a big deal, and it was only for extremely low power applications.
And a single chip.
That was another big deal that I don't think a lot of people recognize. The fact that it was single chip. prior to that, watch chips had offboard drivers.
Yes.
So they were much more difficult to assemble. They were more expensive to manufacture because of the additional devices. Why was it possible for Intel and Microma to come up with a solution that was a single chip as opposed to?
Well, of course, Intel bought Microma, and Intel had the technology that could make Microma, technically speaking, successful. Microma didn't design the chips. Intel had the capability. Microma supplied what the need was.
Okay. One of the things that I've heard repeated a number of times is the motivation for Intel to get into this business, at being it's a technology business. You want to comment on that?
They went into it as a technology business, but it wasn't a technology business. It was a jewelry business. In fact, we showed our watches at jewelry shows and so on. And so it was a jewelry business that, keep in mind, this is before the Fry's and electronic and companies like that were around. So there weren't any technology consumer products. And so as a result, we had a watch that we were selling to jewelry places, and people bought them as jewelry items. And then some people bought them as technology gadgets, but not very many.
Okay. Any other comments you want to make about the personnel and staff that were there, their contributions?
I don't think so. I think the Keith Thompson, who did a super job, ultimately ended up as a vice president at Intel after when we went on and closed the company. We've had other people that, you know, ended up, assistant to the chairman of the board of Intel is an ex-Microma employee. So
they're still there.
They're still around.
Interesting. Okay, Microma had a lot of different values, and I'm not sure that I've gotten the numbering right on this, but the 5010 or 5810 is what I show here that was used in the Microma was the first, we say SOC, and you and I were discussing what that actually meant. Silica on chip or single on chip, the implication, I'll have to go back and correct that later on. But Microma did a lot of other things. So you want to go through and talk about Microma in terms of, you know, kind of who they were and what they did?
Okay. We introduced the display backlighting so that you could, you know, and we put it on all our products so that you could see the time all the time. Originally it was a gold display, which in the light didn't show well, but when we advanced the LCD with backlighting, you had, you could see it all the time. We had some of the other problems we had were, it sounds simple, but it wasn't. We had trouble getting enough watch cases. We got most of our watch cases from Hong Kong. Very difficult arrangement going, getting them from Hong Kong and meeting our needs and so on. So we invested in buying watch case manufacturing equipment from a fellow, I think his name was Paul Zuter. And so we invested time and effort to make watch cases, but we never were successful. It required more, metal fabricating understanding than we had. So we tried hard, but we didn't make it. So
ultimately, you went back and continued to
buy them from Hong Kong.
What was the difficulty getting the supply chain going from Hong Kong?
It was just a difficult arrangement. And lots of reject products. And it was maybe because There were, you know, Fairchild was also in the watch business at the time, and the demands of the digital watch were different watch case demands than for the other products.
Okay. Now, your biggest or your initial large contract was with Penny's, and I believe Irv Cooper was the one responsible for that. Tell us about that and how significant that was.
Well, that was really very significant because Penny's had it throughout their whole chain, and Irv Cooper is the one that lined it up. I remember coming to New York and having dinner with the chief purchasing agent and so on. And they put it in all their stores, and you know, it worked very well for us.
Okay. Were there other things that made things go very effectively?
Well, at about the same time, there was an article in Business Week about Microma and Intel's investment in Microma and the LCD display, which was very positive that the LCD was really the way to go. And it was very positive about Microma and Intel. So it was very, very helpful in marketing our products.
Okay. Now, you told me a story about some of the problems you ran into when you first arrived. Why don't you tell us about that one again?
Well, when I first arrived, and I'm not quite sure how I figured this out, understood it, but our night shift, we had a shipping department that was shipping at night. What they were doing, they were selling watches at night, taking orders over the phone and delivering watches, not for Intel, but for themselves. And so they were actually stealing product and selling it. So I contacted the sheriff's department, and they were kind enough to put an undercover agent in, and we got him on the night shift. And he was a guy driving a big Harley with a big beard. And he actually set up a buy to buy some watches. And Gordon Moore put up the money to give it through the sheriff's department for the buy. And so one night, the sheriff's department, the deputies came in and arrested a lot of people. Of course, we let those people go. So that was sort of an introduction to nighttime stealing for me.
obviously the people were arrested and prosecuted, but I guess I'm curious as to what the effect on the rest of the company was when you did that.
Positive. I have a feeling that maybe a lot of people thought, maybe a lot of people didn't know about it, or maybe the fact that it was going on for quite a while, which I don't know, maybe it was accepted practice, I don't know. But the rest of the people were very, very pleased to find out that we're taking actions that we took.
Excellent. Okay. Now, you had a lot of contact with Bob and Gordon on the development of the liquid crystal display. Why were they so interested in this?
Because it's technology. I mean, you just have to think. They weren't interested in the chips. They know all about chips. But we didn't have a liquid crystal display capability within Intel. And so it was interesting to them. They spent a lot of time with Simon. They'd be looking at him and so on. They spent more time with Simon than they spent with me.
So where did the liquid crystal displays get manufactured?
We did it at Microma.
At Microma.
Yes.
So he had your own process line there for LCD displays. Okay, and I believe it was probably the first LCD process display line in existence.
You may be right. I don't know that, but I was more interested in just getting ours going right.
Now, one of the big problems that we all know that this kind of an industry faced was the fact that it was a distribution jewelry business, not a technology business. But to that end, you introduced a second brand line for Microma.
Yes.
Tell us a little bit about that and where it was marketed.
It was, even though we didn't understand the consumer business, we did have knowledge that you can't sell the same brand to a discounter as you sell to Emporium. So we introduced a second brand called Synchroquartz, and we sold it to the discounters. The discount brands, like, trying to think at the time who they were. It wasn't Costco because they weren't around.
Right.
Oh, I think it was like Sam's. They were Sam's is around.
Sam's was an example of that. All right, good. Was that a successful product line through the discounters?
It was a product line that we sold product to. I wouldn't call it monumentally successful.
Okay. Now, you've talked about the fact that the watch was a piece of jewelry and not a technology issue. Was that, in your opinion, the biggest issue facing the success of Microma as an organization? Was the perception of what you were doing versus the reality in the world?
I'm not sure I understand. Let me say it this way. Intel invested in Microma because it was a technology capability to spread throughout the world and sell product on. It turned out that wasn't true. And Intel was a technical company, technology company. So it really didn't fit. They didn't feel themselves interested in being in a consumer business, competing in consumer business with a product that isn't perceived to be first-class technology and leading.
Okay. Yeah, Intel has always shied away from consumer business, or let's say in future years they continue to shy away from consumer business. You think this whole effort and all was a significant part of their insight into whether they wanted to be in the consumer business? Did it affect how they thought longer term?
I'm not really sure. I think when Andy did the Intel Inside program, since he was so heavily involved in Microma, I think he had more of an understanding of marketing, of a consumer type approach of marketing, than he would have had without what we went through.
Okay, but up to that point in time, everything Intel did was technology.
Yes.
Marketed as technology, not a consumer oriented type of situation.
And in fact, the fact that we convinced Gorgon to do a TV ad, I mean, we did a TV ad with the guy that the priest in MASH, a guy named Christopher, and Gorgon approved the ad, which I think a lot of people in Intel were very surprised, because it was a consumer ad.
Right. Now, we're a little bit out of order in terms of here, so let me come back to the repair facility issue.
Okay.
Let's talk about the ad for a minute. Okay, so this was Intel's very first TV ad.
Yep.
Okay.
Yes.
And I assume you hired a television producer and had all this stuff done?
We hired an agency to put it all together. I can't think of the name of the agency, but we went down when they produced the ad, and Christopher was there, and they did a good job in producing the ad, and we sent out notifications to all of our customers and so on when the ad would be shown and so on.
Okay. You mentioned the fact that you didn't think the ad was as successful as it could have been because of the coordination with the supply chain and whatnot.
We didn't have a good handle on the relationship, the consumer business, and to the supply line. A lot of the customers ran out of product. And we weren't really cognizant of managing when the ads would run, all the stores had inventories in those particular areas and so on. So it was a learning experience.
So the ads ran in particular areas
yes.
at different times.
Yes.
Oh, I see.
And we let people know they're running, but we didn't monitor their inventory.
Okay. One, I can understand that. Was it Chiat Day possibly the agency that you were talking
about? No, it wasn't Chai. Chai Day ran the, was ultimately ran the Intel ads, but I can't remember who it was.
Okay, because we went through a secession from McKenna's organization to Chai Day and whatnot.
And it wasn't McKenna either.
But this was somebody else ran it. Okay, well, we'll look back into that. Maybe Rich will have some insight into it. You also negotiated a bunch of agreements as you shut down Microma. So Microma actually goes on until when? What was the date that you actually closed the company, or the time frame?
Oh, I don't remember the date.
Well, not a specific date, but the year, 1980 or 19.
I think it was. We closed it in. I'd have to look. Probably 19, maybe 76.
Okay. Yep. Okay. And in doing that, you basically spent a lot of time negotiating watch agreements and whatnot with other companies, and supplying product for a long time, but. Eventually, as you shut this whole thing down, how did that go? Who went where? How was it received by the employees?
Well, I think we had, fortunately, Intel was hiring a lot of people, and Microma employees, once we announced it, had first shot at all the openings, all the people that were considered competent and had good reviews and so on and were doing their jobs. And we placed anybody and everybody that wanted to be replaced. So we had first, we, Microma, had first call on the openings.
Okay. Which, now, I believe the engineering organization actually went with the sale of Microma.
Now, when we sold Microma, we sold it to Timex. And we had an agreement with Timex. They took the whole engineering organization in total. And also part of the agreement with Timex was we would supply the watch chips. We had a long-term agreement with them. And so it was a very good relationship. Yeah. And we.
Okay. In previous conversations, we've discussed the fact that they basically took everything.
Equipment,
tools,
everything we had.
And the engineering organization stayed down on Bub Road locally.
No, actually, they moved to another facility that Timex ran.
Ah, okay.
And the total engineering organization went with them.
Okay.
And Jim Beck went with them and ran it all.
Okay. What happened to Simon?
Simon got a top-notch engineering job back at Intel. And stayed there for many years. In fact, he left and started his own company. And after, when I retired, I even went on his board.
Okay. Good.
And of course, I mentioned earlier that Keith Thompson stayed with the company,
right,
and became a vice president and general manager of a division. And at the time, Liz McElfish had already gone back to Intel before that, but Dick Cermone, who was the running personnel for Microma, went back to Intel and ultimately became vice president of human resources. So Intel was very good at finding places for all the people that wanted to stay and who were, you know, good people.
All right. Rich Melman as well, I know he went back and
yes.
was with us in marketing at Intel for a long time. Interestingly enough, I think that really is kind of a measure of how companies operated at the time. They were really concerned about their employees and they wanted to make sure that things worked out fairly well. Do you agree with that? Is that a?
Well, I can't speak for all companies, but I can speak for Intel. Intel was more than understanding and wanting to make sure that their employees at Microma were given proper opportunities and jobs in the company. As I mentioned earlier, the one of the chairman of the board's assistant used to work at Microma.
All right, so one of the things we kind of skipped over was some of the business opportunities that you negotiated, some supply agreements and whatnot. There was one large Swiss company that you worked with, but it didn't work out particularly well. You want to talk about that a little bit?
Not particularly. this was after when I first arrived at the company. We negotiated a large module contract with a company called SSIH, and they produced Omega watches and so on. And we negotiated the agreement, but it turns out we couldn't meet the specifications when we had put it into manufacturing. We had lost a fair number of engineering people when we had management changes. And so as a result, we failed to be able to meet the contract. But it was a good learning experience, because rest assured after that we were very careful in what we did, and we produced, you know, high quality products, and we had good quality control, and really had a top-notch engineering organization.
Right. And you delivered on time, on quality,
yes,
for a long time.
In fact, along that line, Andy Grove sent us a great big poster with the four managers' names on it, showing a watch. And on it says, Intel delivers, Microma also delivers. And if you know Andy Grove, that was a top-notch compliment for a tough taskmaster to the Microma people.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think that really was. A compliment. You also set up distribution organizations in a number of other countries?
Yes, we had distribution in Japan, mm-hmm. Europe, but not South America. But we had distributors that distributed, but we had organizations in those other ones. Mm-hmm. In fact, we had one fellow that reported, Irv Cooper, was in Germany and ran Europe.
Was that a new learning experience for you? I know you were in Europe for the real business at Microma, at Memorex.
I wasn't selling product there. I was buying a lot of product there. But this is our first shot at, in my life, for distributing in Europe. It worked out well.
Yeah. So as you sold the assets and the product and the technology to Microma, Microma to Timex. You mentioned that there was another potential buyer at the time, but that failed to work out. Why? Who was it and why?
Oh, it was, for some reason, it was Gillette. In fact, I went in to meet with Gillette. I didn't tell my people I was going in to meet with Gillette, because by that time we knew we were wanting to sell the company. But we hadn't necessarily announced it, but we had a contact at Gillette, and I went in and made a proposal to them to sell the company. And they were interested. They sent people out, but they didn't come out. They were coming out to buy modules, because I didn't want everybody to know we're sort of thinking about going on the block. And they did a lot of investigating and so on, but ultimately decided they weren't going to enter that consumer business.
Okay. I mean, they were clearly have the distribution,
they got the
knowledge
distribution
and everything, but selling razor blades and selling watches was completely different.
I think that's what they figured out. And I think they felt as though the margins on razor blades are very high.
Okay, and the introduction to Timex was through a contact from Art Rock?
Yeah, Arthur Rock, for some reason, I don't know how he made this, but there's a fellow by the name of Angus McDonald, who works in the area of finding homes for companies or selling companies. And so I worked with Angus and got working with Timex. But it was through Arthur initially.
Okay. I'm interested to understand, you know, kind of the overall perception of Microma. We also sold, you also sold the name Microma to someone. And so Microma remained a brand. But the perception in a lot of places is that Microma was pretty much a failure in terms of dumping a lot of money into something that didn't succeed. Would you agree with that on a long-term basis?
No, I don't think so, because the fact that we sold the company to a first-class company, Timex is not sort of a run-of-the-mill company. They perceived value in it. The company was probably one of the leader in the business at the time. The fact that it didn't fit with Intel's what they wanted to do with their technology approach to the world didn't detract from that it had value. And we did sell the brand, the name, which sort of surprised Gordon. But we sold the brand name. I think we got $100,000 for it. And next, Microma employee was working for a Swiss watch company. But I think there was a lot was learned while we did it. And I don't have the P&L for saying, well, whether we Gordon lost or not lost, but on net, it was a positive experience.
Okay, and a positive financial experience.
And the people that were kept were proud of that they worked at Microma.
Yeah, I think they still are today. I've talked to a number
of
them. Okay, any other closing statements on Microma?
No, I don't think so. I think you covered it very well.
The one thing we didn't talk about was the repair facility.
Oh, that's right. I forgot about it.
Yeah.
This is one of the things that's very positive for Intel, is that within, I think our warranty was, I think, 3 years. I think it may have been 4 years. And Intel wanted to make sure we had a facility to honor the warranty, no matter what happened to the company. So we set up a separate repair facility, a warranty facility, that ran for, I think, maybe 4 years beyond when we sold to Timex. We didn't warrant Timex products, but we warranted Intel products, Microma, and that facility. In fact, I ran that facility amongst other jobs I had, made sure it was there and the people were there, but they were Intel employees. And was there for at least 4 years.
Okay.
So along with placing all the people, and the warranty says that, you know, the company had a lot of integrity.
So we're going to move on from Microma to Intel Corporation. When Microma was closed, you went to work for Intel directly, and you worked there for another 11 years, I think.
Yes.
So
yes.
Let's talk about, you know, some of the things you went in and did. And I think the first one that's particularly important is automotive. And that's a huge business today, and this is back in the mid-70s that Intel is just getting into the automotive business. So tell us what you did there and what the significance of that was.
I was working for Les Vedez then at the time, and we negotiated an agreement with Ford to take over the development of what they call the engine control number 4. It had been initially Motorola, but we got the award from them to design the EEC-4. And that was the design the product and did the whole design and everything, working with the engineers and so on. So we were very lucky, did a good job, and did a great job in getting it done.
Was this a competitive thing with other companies designing other products?
It was competitive with Motorola, but Motorola was the second source on this, which for Intel, having a second source wasn't something Intel's used to.
And the result, however, was Intel still enjoyed most of the volume.
We got probably the major part through the whole life of the contract. My guess is, probably in today's environment, not big buck, but probably $300 or $400 million worth of product we sold to Ford during that time frame.
So why did Intel get such a big share and Motorola get relatively little?
Because Motorola is a second source and required, they had to have the capability to produce the product in a way that we designed it. They didn't design it, we did.
So process technology is a big issue there?
Process technology is always a big issue. Now we gave them all the information, but getting the information doesn't mean you can do it.
Okay, so contractually there was no requirement that you go teach them how to go do it, just to supply them the information.
We would supply and answer the questions. We didn't do anything subversive or anything like that. We gave them everything they needed. Or give their, and of course, getting what they needed and what they asked for. Maybe they didn't, if they didn't ask for it, we didn't give it to them. We gave them everything that was in the contract.
Okay. Actually, Intel had done some second source things before that, even back in the 1103, the original 1K memory. There were half a dozen other companies and one or two second sources that Intel supplied. Did that experience affect how this one went down?
I don't think so, because automotive at that time was not a big thing at Intel, and so we had a small group and not a lot involved in the previous second sourcing.
Okay, so you went back and negotiated the agreement. I assume there were other people involved in the negotiation from Intel side as well?
Yes. Probably the prime person was Brian Knowles. I don't know if you know Brian.
I do.
But absolutely superb marketing guy. Leaves no stone unturned, either with the customer or the people he works for, to make sure that the work, that everything gets done.
How about Videz? Was he directly involved
yes.
in some of this stuff?
In fact, Videz got involved with when we would go to Ford and so on. And within, in fact, I even brought the Ford engineers, the top purchasing people and the top technical people, to meet Andy Grove. Of course, that was a surprise for them because Andy was wearing his gold chain, and they weren't quite used to that. But they understood him and they really appreciated it.
You also worked with Daimler-Benz. Why don't you tell us a little bit about it? That wasn't a product business.
That wasn't, but we negotiated a technology information agreement with them in return for some dollars and so on, which were, it worked out okay, but we didn't get a lot out of it. But it was still a great agreement because you know, Daimler-Benz is an important company.
Okay. At the time, had you hoped it would go further into supplying product?
Yes.
Okay. And why do you think it didn't?
You know, I don't really know. I don't know because it was shortly after that that the we decided to move the automotive group to Arizona, and I didn't want to move to Arizona, so I talked Craig Barrett into taking it, so and he followed through on that.
Okay. It's interesting that there's no mention in our conversation previously of anything with either Chrysler or with General Motors. Were they targets for us?
Yes. General Motors was a big target. And we met with them a lot, went there, but never successfully closed an agreement with them. And they were a big Motorola user. But we never tried and tried and tried.
You think one of the major reasons was because they wouldn't want to be dealing with us since we were a supplier of their major competition at Ford?
I don't think so, no. I don't think it had anything to do with that. I think it had to do with that they were really tied in with Motorola.
Okay. And what about Chrysler? I personally remember calling on Chrysler down in Huntsville years ago, but...
We never... had ain't much to do with Chrysler on keeping in mind engine control units, and I don't know what Chrysler was doing.
Well, in my early days, it was entertainment consoles.
Yeah.
Okay, so it had nothing to do with engine control at that point in time. So after you passed this automotive on to Craig, you went on to do some other stuff, but I'm curious in your opinion as to why Intel essentially got out of the automotive business.
You know, I wasn't involved in that, but it has to do with the manufacturing capability and where the biggest return was in product. And the microprocessors and so on, actually when you're trying to start wafers for product, automotive products had lesser margins than some of the other ones. And as a result, the effort was put on other products other than automotive.
Yeah, I think that's the issue. I mean, I personally remember even before automotive of sitting in wafer start meetings and trying to get starts for things that had less profit margin, and it was a difficult sell.
But we did sell a lot of product before it, and it was good, and the product was good.
Yeah, okay. From the automotive organization, you went on to manage facilities, legal, admin, and purchasing. Big change?
Yeah, actually, it went in pieces. When they moved the automotive, I ran facilities, and then I ran the marketing communications group. Those are separate jobs. And then I ran human resources. So I ran the three of those as separate groups at different times. Facilities for Larry Hutnick and David Al for marketing communications, and Andy for human resources. And then when Larry Hutnick moved into sales, I then took over all the administrative, which included facilities, facilities, and so on, and including finance and MIS and the purchasing, and essentially all legal and so on.
Okay. And you actually negotiated a number of contracts and a number of legal issues. Okay, I think the AMD one was yours.
Yeah, in fact, AMD, I did that with John Calhoun, and we negotiated the AMD contract, and took us quite a while to do it, and got both sides to agree. In fact, then later on, we had lots of legal entanglements and went on for years.
It did go on for years.
Went on for years.
So this was the first negotiation with AMD?
Yes.
Because I think there were two other actual lawsuits filed.
Yes.
That went on from there.
But we negotiated, in fact, I remember when we finished the negotiation, John and I, we had the Intel management, which included people like Karsten and so on, and the AMD management in the same room, and then we described to them the agreement to make sure they understood it. And that was very critical in the lawsuits later on, so that we had the people really understood, because they were involved by the people who did the negotiations.
Yeah, it did go on for a long, long time,
yes.
However. You also set up a number of operations in different countries. You want to talk us through some of those? And I think the UK one was the first one that you mentioned.
In fact, I did that maybe when I was in automotive, but I was on my way to Germany, and Larry Hutnick asked me to go into the UK and negotiate an agreement to buy land in England at the beginning of the European operation.
Okay. Now, just to set the context there, we had European operation for sales in Brussels.
Yes.
For years.
But that was for sales.
Right. And so this was for a lot more than sales, although the sales organization would move here too.
Yes. It was the intent, though, to have enough area, facility, land, and so on, to expand Europe beyond sales. Mm-hmm. So I went into the UK and along with Keith Chappell, and I don't know if you remember Keith Chappell. Keith Chappell was running European sales. So Keith and I and a guy named Jerry Stratbucker from facilities on an all day and all night negotiation with the city council of Swindon negotiated buying land. Our first approach was I had Jerry Stratbucker go through intel, what they did, how many people we were going to hire, why it was important for them to have us, which it was, because they were going to move us to a sort of an outlying area. But ultimately, we negotiated to buy the land we wanted at a fair price.
They just didn't appreciate initially what Intel was all about.
Well, then another technology company, because they had to understand that our intentions were, and they really didn't. So we took half the negotiation explaining who we were, and then the rest of the night negotiating.
So this kind of sets a trend for how you do negotiations for sites and equipment and whatnot in the future.
Yeah, it's important, I felt, that first of all, I need to understand exactly what it is we want and what it is the people we're going to deal with, what their positions are and so on. But it's important for when you do that, that they understand what Intel is all about, what their intent. And so you want to come across as what we are, a very responsible company, high integrity and so on. And one that's going to be bring lots of good things to whatever our agreement is. And that's always been pretty successful.
Mm-hmm. Okay. You did a number of operations here in the U.S. as well. Folsom and Albuquerque come to mind there.
Yeah, we bought the land in Folsom. I was very, very involved in that. And then I was also running the MIS group later on, and so we transferred the MIS group. I promoted doing that up to Folsom because they give us guaranteed supply of electrical.
Now, MIS stands for?
Information Systems Group, sorry.
Okay.
And then in Albuquerque, we went in unannounced. We didn't tell anybody who we were. And we went in and we met with the mayor of Albuquerque and told him what we wanted to do. And then we negotiated with different companies for property unannounced, other than that we were a technology company. And then we finally located what we want, bought it. And it so happened it also had a big building on it.
Oh, already had a big
mm-hmm.
building on it. So you were able to use that
mm-hmm.
as part of the facility.
Yes.
I didn't understand that. What was the emphasis for going in effectively blind to the people you're negotiating with?
It was because Intel was still a big company, and going in blind rather than trying to guess what Intel was all trying to negotiate with us because we thought we had a lot of money. Once we identified who we wanted to buy, then we went in to them and explained the company and what we're doing and so on. But initially, to go through to find out what we thought we wanted, we did that unannounced. Once we found what we wanted, then we went in and negotiated what we wanted to buy, told them what we're going to do and so on.
So you think you got probably a much better deal by doing it that way as opposed to going in with this big technology company with lots of money?
Yeah, well, see, we already decided what we wanted, and we eliminated all the other people by not telling who we were, and then we negotiated with someone we wanted to negotiate with.
Excellent.
And they didn't try to hold us up to start with.
And you also did some stuff in the Soviet Union or Russia at the time. Why don't you tell us about
that?
That sounded like a rather interesting negotiation.
What we did there was Europe had, in Germany, there was a guy there by the name of Dmitry Rotov, who was assigned to start up to work in Russia. and he essentially worked for me doing that. So I would go in and work with Dimitri on sales and locations, and we were trying to locate offices there. In fact, along that line, we had a meeting with the mayor. I don't think he's called mayor, but this is Soviet Union now. He was in charge of Moscow, and it was very difficult to find facilities, and he offered to give us facilities. In return, all he wanted was one Volvo and three copy machines. So obviously we didn't get any facility, but we finally did locate something on the outskirts of Moscow, and we located there. Now this is after the coup. This is after the Soviet Union was broken up, and so as a result, we hired for security. We hired ex KGB guys, and so we didn't have any problems with security, and stuff went through customs very easily. That was probably Dimitri's idea, but it's a good idea.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. You also had to negotiate for Intel's name.
Yeah, that, you know, I don't know quite, I don't know how the Soviet system worked, but they had allocated names or something, and someone they had was using the name Intel based upon Soviet rules and so on. So I had a meeting with top Soviet officials. I don't know how big top they were. It was a big room full of them. Explained what Intel was all about, what our intentions were, and that we plan to be here and we're going to be here, but we need our name back. And I don't know how they did it, but we got our name back. And I'm not even sure throughout Intel anybody ever knew that we had this going on.
And you also set up some other stuff in the eastern areas?
Yeah, the eastern bloc. I worked with setting up stuff in Poland and the Czech Republic.
Okay, and that really involved introducing a lot of people to what Intel was, just like you've done other places.
Yes.
Did you find that once they understood who you were and who Intel was, that they were enthusiastic about this, wanted to move forward, or was it?
Well, let's see, a lot of them, we already had some sales operations in some of these, so they know a little bit about Intel. But I think having people come from what they perceived corporate meant that Intel really is planning to be here and expand.
You also did some of the initial operations in both India and China. That had to be a completely different situation than Europe or Eastern Bloc. Why don't you tell us a little bit about those places?
In India, I met with just top officials and so on. India was a different situation in that we weren't selling a lot of product yet, so I was involved in getting India aware of what we're doing. In China, I met with the vice premier, and I don't know how it got set up, but I met with the vice premier and was able, through discussions, to convince him to standardize on Intel architecture for the education group. In fact, I remember saying to me, well, can you tell your president to standardize on Boeing engines for all? And he said, no, our president can't, but you can do this because you have the power. By the way, he ultimately sent out a memo or whatever he did. I'm not sure we got a lot of product, but we got notoriety.
Mm-hmm. I bet you did. And finally, I think you spent some time picking up the first land site in Puerto Rico. Now, that was assembly and test, or?
I went there with Dave Pratt, and I don't know, you know, maybe you know
Dave. I know the name, I don't
okay.
know.
Okay, and we were, it was the, it, I think it was a test and assembly, but I'm not sure. But we didn't have any land there. And so we met with Puerto Rico, and we went through our usual approach of explaining Intel. They just wanted to talk about what they want to sell us and how much it's going to cost. And so I said, no, we have to take a few hours, and we're going to explain to you what we're all about. So we negotiated a deal on Puerto Rico land. But Dave is the one that knew what they wanted I didn't figure out what we wanted. I went in and helped negotiate it.
Mm-hmm. Interesting. Okay. From there, you took over and did the marketing communications thing with McKenna and Chiat Day. Why don't you tell us a little bit about how that came about and the split between the agencies and all?
Well, at that time, I was working for Bill Davidow, and we changed from McKenna to Chiat Day at the time, and that was sort of in the works even when I got there.
Now, that was just for advertising, though,
that
right?
was just for advertising. Regis was still doing the PR stuff. But one of the problems was having was that, and with Chiat Day, that the different division managers, we'd have all the advertising run, get the ads together, and that the ads being ready to be published, and the division manager would come in and want to change something. So we put in a new ruling that said division managers have to be involved in the production of the ads and the development of the ads if they want to come in at the end and change them. Otherwise, they can't change them. And for some reason or other, they all agreed to it. And it worked out well because the ads sometimes, I know there was one with a motorcycle and the guy didn't like the slant of the motorcycle. But they changed the ad. So the ads were better from then on, I think.
And they probably came out on time.
And they all came out on time. And that was with Chiat Day.
Okay. But Regis was still doing all the PR.
He was still doing PR.
And I found it interesting in a conversation with Regis some years ago where he thought that was such a great deal for him because he'd always run advertising as a loss leader. And I think that probably meant that Intel all of a sudden was paying a lot more for advertising than they had in the past.
Yeah, I don't know whether they were or they weren't, but.
Interesting. And from there, you went on to run human resources. Made some interesting changes there.
Yeah, in fact, in human resources, I changed the name from personnel to human resources and convinced Andy to agree to it. Although the name personnel was, in the industry, all technical companies call that area personnel. So this was new and different for Andy, and he finally agreed to it. And I thought I wasn't sure whether it was going to be over my dead body or not, but he agreed to it not because I overwhelmed him. You don't overwhelm Andy. No. He agreed to it because he finally felt as though the personnel department had earned the right to be called human resources. I mean, stop and think, Andy. I mean, he said that, and that's really what the intent was.
Interesting. So, Jay, you know. He can change, is what you're saying. Okay. And from there, you went on to run ASIC operations, which was a business that was relatively short-lived at Intel.
Yes.
So tell us a little bit about that.
Jack Karsten was running ASIC and started ASIC, and Jack had decided to leave the company. And Andy asked me if I would go in and run ASIC. And so I went in and I brought in, after talking to everybody, because they, you know, we had, you know, Kudusharov ran manufacturing, Ron Smith ran the technical area, and I forgot who the other ones were. But it was clear to me we didn't have our act together. So I brought in, a fellow by the name Andy Rappaport. Do you know him?
I do.
And very smart guy, knew the ASIC business. And so he talked to all the people, Andy, Gordon, everybody involved, and came up with a conclusion that Intel had no business being in there, that we brought nothing to the market and proposed that we get out of it, which since it wasn't making any money, and Gordon and Andy were pleased about. And we turned the manufacturing over to Parker, or it was that time was probably Mike Splinter, and the technology and marketing to Dave House's group. and the sales went in, back into integrated sales.
Okay.
Because then it had its own manufacturing plant.
Well, and therefore there was product that you had committed going out the door that you had to continue to service.
Yeah.
It's just not going forward. You don't want to invest there. I've always found the work that you did in government affairs and the external industry relations stuff of a lot of interest. Okay, so why don't you tell us about that? Because that's kind of again, another interesting move on your part.
Well, I sat on the American Electronics Board and worked with the SIA a lot. And probably did a lot relating to how it works with the industry and so on. But more important, while I was doing all that, I stayed involved in Intel and negotiating different agreements and getting different things done. In fact, along that line, we did the final agreement with AMD using a mediator, Craig, myself, and Dunlap did a final agreement. That was the final agreement we had to do. And then at the time, while I was doing these government affairs, I also negotiated a settlement with Fairchild. We had groundwater problems, both Fairchild and Intel. But Fairchild's involvement was much larger than ours.
So this was back in the original facilities that Intel occupied.
And so we negotiated with them for them to pick up our responsibilities. And we, of course, paid some money. Not a lot, but they took on the overall responsibility. In fact, it was sort of an interesting negotiation because, again, the fellow from Fairchild and myself negotiated it all. When we got done, he called his lawyer, and I called our lawyer. It wasn't Tom, it was, I've forgotten who it was. I think it was Tom. And so, on a conference call, we explained to the two lawyers what we agreed to and for them to write it up.
So this goes back to your negotiating style. Negotiate with the people responsible, okay? But don't use attorneys to do the negotiation.
But attorneys can write it out.
Right.
So and it's so far it's worked well for me.
Okay. You gave me a bottle of the groundwater that was from that site.
Yes.
And I'm going to actually trying to find a way to photograph the label on it so we can include it in this thing. So it should be interesting. But just for everybody listening, the groundwater itself was bottled up and then given out to everybody that participated in the negotiation?
Well, it was everybody we didn't give it to Fairchild. That was from our own facilities group.
Okay.
Larry Borgman ran the group, and he had those drawn up. And that was before we negotiated the settlement.
Ah, okay. Well, it's Udi Mountain View or something.
You're right, Mountain View. So, Mountain View site.
So we'll hopefully include that label
in the
final product here. So you also went on and did several other negotiations. Why don't you talk about some of those things?
Okay, there was the intellectual property lawsuit with Hughes Aircraft. And don't ask me why Hughes, I don't know. They had intellectual property that they felt some of our products violated. And they sent us letters and so on. So I put together a presentation to go over with them, and Gordon and I went down to meet with them. And I went through my presentation, which was that one of which recognized that they had some intellectual property, but wasn't significant in our view. Their conclusion was that we didn't take them seriously. But then later on, they contacted us and sent a lawyer up. So a lawyer and myself, Carl Silverman, Intel lawyer, met with their lawyer with a mediator. The mediator we'd used for AMD. And we resolved it with our then into the night. But and then we both got signed and they're gone. But it was because of Gordon going down there made the difference.
Interesting. I don't think Gordon was involved in a lot of negotiations like that.
Well, no, he didn't do the final negotiation.
No,
his presence said that Intel is paying attention to it, even though they said we didn't take them seriously.
Yeah, okay, that comes across a lot better. Okay, you also did some IBM and some IP issues with a Florida semiconductor company.
With IBM, there was a conflict revolving rights. Some early negotiations with IBM, we gave them rights to different things, different products.
So and this is back in the x86
yes,
time frame.
Yes, the x86 stuff. But for some reason or other, we didn't fulfill all the things we said we would do, or they didn't think we did. And so they were going to file a lawsuit against us. So Andy identified me to work with IBM. And so I worked, now this time we did work, I worked with IBM, but it was their top lawyer. I've forgotten the guy's name right now, but, and so I worked with him for a long period and met down there with him. And I had another fellow working with me, Jack Salvador, who you may or may not know. And so, we finally ended up negotiating a settlement where we paid them $30 million. But along with the settlement, they gave us a cross license for all their intellectual property. That was part of the, you know, we'll pay you the 30, but here's else, what else we want. So we closed it and we were very pleased with it. And went on fine.
Well, certainly Intel and IBM had an interesting long-term relationship.
Yes.
Even to the point of IBM investing a lot of money in Intel when critically needed.
And when they needed it, they used it at the time for investing in process development.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So everything worked out fairly well. And then there was, do you remember who the semiconductor company in Florida was?
I can't think. I have a feeling it might have been Harris. But I'm not sure.
They were located in the Orlando area.
Yeah.
Because
I remember going down there with hotter than blazes, and I negotiated with the fellow that ran the company. In fact, I remember he let me use an office in his legal area. And I had to tell him I couldn't sit in a legal area. So I took over his office. So we negotiated in his office, and I used his phones to settle it and so on.
So quite a bit of stuff that you, particularly in the legal area, that I find very interesting. You also did a lot of government affair industry external relationships, but we really haven't talked about that. You recall any specific things, particularly in the government relation areas, that were something we should cover?
No,
here?
I don't think so. It was, you know, it was more just more AEA activities on the board
so
and
mainly
so on.
AEA and SIA
yeah,
types
right.
of things.
Yeah.
Okay. Was this a time at which you were also approached to take over and run the Semiconductor Industry Association itself?
Oh, no, I wasn't asked to do that. That was something Bob Noyce had asked me to join him in Austin, and he would do the technical and I would do the administrative, which is, as a, you know, it's sort of like, as I mentioned to someone before, it's sort of like God coming down and asking you to join him. But Austin wasn't on my list of places to live.
I understand that. So you retired in 96, and any other comments about Intel as a corporation, place to work, thoughts you want to share?
Other than the fact that it's a first-class company, very demanding, but a company with a big heart and understanding of people, And even more important than that, drives people to do, not only to do what do their best, but to drives them to do more than they originally thought they were capable of. That's really sort of key. And it's sort of like Andy was good at that. And of course, Andy's words was that just doing the right things isn't enough. You have to do the right things right, which sort of, I thought that was, and those things meant a lot to me as I was working.
Okay. And how about, in closing, we just talk a little bit about what you've done since you retired from Intel. That's 96, so that's 20 years ago now.
Well,
haven't been sitting still.
I've served on a couple of boards, Tyenn Corporation, which is a computer supply corporation run by Simon Chang. I was on the board of Wright Company, which is a wealth management company putting together charitable organization, charitable trusts, and so on. And then a Tellurian, which was in a software company. And in each one of those, I taught the management by objectives programs to their staffs.
So you've mentioned MBOs at several different companies here, okay? And a lot of people, I don't think, understand what MBO or management by objectives really is. Why don't you describe that?
It's a matter of putting together it's a management technique where I wanted to build a plant in Los Angeles. I started with, I had an objective to produce a plastic reel for $2. Now, some objectives is, I then put together a program, how would I do it? And then the details on dates and so on you're gonna do, come up with different proposals. And then I came up with a plastic plant and also the details of when you do that. So the original objectives, it's a management technique that drives you to accomplish a objective.
Okay.
And how you're gonna do it, and the dates you're gonna do it, and to be measured on a regular basis.
Okay, so not only is it managing it, but it's measuring,
yes,
the success of the individual tactics and all that went into that type of thing. I've always used that. I learned it at Intel, which was my first experience. What I have found interesting, however, is that there's a lot of companies who resist using MBO techniques.
Yeah, it's too bad, because it's a super technique. And Intel has done, I don't know what they're doing now, but Intel's did a good job on it initially.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I've asked a couple of friends if they can recall where we might find a copy of the old MBO course that was taught at Intel, because there was actually one developed.
Yeah, there was, yeah.
So, and a lot of us took it. Now, I tried to use it in a number of places, and unfortunately, I actually had management in some cases say, oh no, that's something you do at Intel you don't do here, which I found just, as you said, amazing.
Technique really works. At the three companies I worked with, I had their top people do their, and I would rate their objectives. And it went into their reviews if they didn't, you know.
Mm-hmm. Okay, any things you want to close with?
No, I think I've spent a lot of time, I've invested a lot of real estate over the years in Colorado and here. Takes up a lot of time managing it, but I like being involved in it. Still do sailing. I have a boat down in Monterey, and at one time, I also am a qualified mediator. I have a qualification, and I did some mediating while retiring. I haven't done a lot of it because mm-hmm. it takes up a lot of time.
Yeah, it's a tremendously complex process.
Yeah.
But all the experiences that we've talked about here, particularly in doing contracts and negotiating for facilities and whatnot, that all goes into the mediation situation.
Yeah.
So, a national one. Okay, I think we've covered as much, unless you have anything you want to add?
No, I think that'll do it.
Dick, thank you for your time
okay.
today.